If you're the kind of person who remembers your dreams, there's a pretty good chance that what you remember is in color, playing out like a movie scene. That's how most people dream, or at least that's how most people dream now. But for several decades of the 20th century, when people's dreams played out like a movie scene, those scenes looked like the movies of the day. Black and white. As far as we can tell, an entire generation stopped dreaming in color, and we're still trying to understand why. There aren't a lot of formal studies of the content of dreams before the early 1900s, but we do have anecdotal reports from Aristotle, Descartes, and Sigmund Freud referring to colors in dreams. But one of the earliest studies of dreams happened in 1915 and reported that only 20% of dreams contained color. A study of college students in 1942 found that 29% of participants reported occasional colored dreams, and a study in the 1950s showed only 9% of people dreamed in color. Dreaming in color was so rare that doctors and psychotherapists opined on what was wrong with people who did see a full color palette in their sleep. They suggested drug use, migraines, anxiety, and even stress and shock from seeing your dad's genitals at some point, which is very on brand for mid-century psychoanalysts. Let us all just take a moment to heap judgment upon Freud. But then, like Dorothy landing in Oz, things shifted and the dream world started to be more colorful. A study from 1962 reported more than 80% of dreams contained color, and since then, the percentage of dreams with color has remained firmly around 70%. So did everyone start doing drugs and getting migraines in the 60s? Well, maybe, but there are a few other ideas about what's going on here. The first is that the methods used to measure the phenomenon of color in dreams have changed in ways that might be less biased against reporting color. It's really hard to measure what happens in dreams because, well, we're dreaming. And as most of us can probably attest, it can be difficult or impossible to remember your dreams in the morning, so researchers have to get a little creative. 6 of the 9 studies done before 1960 used questionnaires that asked people to describe their dreams for the last week or month. And there are all sorts of things that can happen in that time. You might misremember or forget things, or your recollection might be colored, so to speak, by the standard way folks consumed visual media at the time, in black and white. In contrast, a lot of the studies done after 1960 exploited the discovery that we dream during REM sleep. So instead of asking people to describe their dreams from weeks ago, the researchers would wake participants up during REM sleep and ask them to report on what they were dreaming about right then and there. Other studies relied on dream diaries, where people would record their dreams immediately upon waking. The idea with either of these methods is that they were less likely to be distorted by memory or cultural experiences. And yet, historically, writings on dreams from before the 1900s didn't rely on people reporting their dreams immediately upon waking, and they still reported color dreams. And a study in 2008 actually directly compared questionnaires and dream diaries and didn't find any significant difference in the number of color or grayscale dreams reported. So it might not be a question of methodology after all, but if not that, then what? We'll find out after this quick funding break.
Thank you to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. Brilliant is an online learning platform that gives you the opportunity to learn something whenever you have just a little bit of time. They get that you have other things going on in your life, so they offer lessons that you can complete in a matter of minutes when you're waiting to pick up your kid or prescription or food. You don't need to set aside time to use Brilliant. It fits into your life. You can find Brilliant at brilliant.org/scishow, the QR code, or at the link in the description. That link will give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free.
The other hypothesis for black and white dreams in the 20th century is that our dreams reflect the media we were raised with. By 1915, photography had been common for decades, and cameras came to the mass market in 1901, so most people were familiar with black and white images, and by the studies of the 40s, black and white movies were a common weekend escape. But Color TV rolled out between 1954 and 1972, coinciding with the shift to color dreams recorded in the 1960s. To test this idea, researchers have compared the reported color scales of dreams between people of different generations. One study in 2008 looked at participants born before 1953 and participants born after 1983. It found that the older participants did indeed report a higher frequency of black and white dreams, and of the older group, those who had experienced with black and white media as kids reported more black and white dreams than those who weren't exposed to this type of media. A study done in Germany in 2017 found a similar pattern, and a study done in China found that 11 was the magical age, with people exposed to media in color before 11 more likely to have color dreams. While all of these studies did show generational differences in the color of dreams, the number of people reporting grayscale dreams is still not nearly as high as what was reported in the studies from the 40s and 50s. That might be because people have gotten exposure to more colored media since then. This type of generational study is difficult, though, because in general, older people report or remember fewer dreams than younger people do, and it doesn't necessarily capture whether people are experiencing dreams differently or just remembering their dreams differently once they're awake. But despite what I thought as a kid, the world was not in black and white prior to the 1960s. So although media was in grayscale, the vast majority of people's lives were spent in color. So why would our media experience override our real world experience in dreams? Our dreams don't necessarily reflect the way we experience the world. I, for one, have never experienced a pirate skeleton crawl out of the ground in my grandmother's front yard in real life. And the same may be true for visual experiences. One paper reported 3 cases of people with color blindness who had dreams in full color. So even though their realities weren't in full color, their dreams were. But that's definitely not true for everyone who's colorblind, so clearly there are no hard and fast rules. What's more, our media consumption does have a big impact on what happens in dreamland. One study found that watching something violent in the 90 minutes before bed makes it 13 times more likely that you're going to have violent dreams. And it's not just immediately before bed, like your parents may have warned you about. People who tend to watch more violent media tend to have more violent dreams, even if you're not experiencing anything violent in your day-to-day life. So there's something about media that makes it wriggle its way into our dreams. Maybe there's something about the experience of watching things that makes them more impactful. Sitting in front of a screen and having something directed straight into your eyes is more intimate than experiencing something in the broader world. Or there may be something especially powerful about the stories themselves. Either way, media influences our dreams in frequency, content, and form. And if the color of media is so powerful, what about other aspects? Kids are consuming way more 3D virtual reality content now than they have in the past. So who knows, maybe in a few years our dreams will change again. And in the meantime, I'm just going to be grateful that smell-o-vision never took off.